Hello friends, it's a pleasure to once again present to you a report of the meeting of the Diocesan Council that took place on June 16th and 17th, 2017. The first evening that we met, we had a fairly major conversation about the medical plan offered to clergy and lay employees of the diocese. Our Human Resources VSST has been looking at the plan now on and off for several years, comparing the plan that we currently have with Blue Cross Medevie with the National Church's plan offered through Manulife. The committee had done a significant amount of work comparing the two plans, and with the principal aim of both providing for a continuity of benefits that we currently have, while at the same time trying to be conscious of the long-term sustainability of the plan. Diocesan Council did vote at its meeting to move their plan from Medevie Blue Cross to the National Church plan as of September 1st. This will give us both a reduction overall in the cost of the premiums that we currently pay, and the plan in most cases, although it's always a little bit difficult to compare plans because they're not identical, but in most cases actually provide an increase in the benefits offered to plan members. Information will be circulated. As a matter of fact, we're preparing some information right now, this first week of July, to be circulated to the current members of our plan. We also received a report from the Budget Task Group. Their initial comments on the 2018 budget and its preparation. There were no numbers presented to us at this time, primarily because there are a number of parishes which have yet to supply their annual reports to the diocese, and we require the financial returns from each parish in order to calculate the amount of assessable income that we have to work with. And as of the date of the Diocesan Council meeting, at least six of the larger parishes in the diocese had not done so. So the Budget Task Group couldn't actually provide us with a draft budget, but they did provide some information about assumptions behind their budget preparations. We will continue to use the 19.25% allotment rate in its preparation. And at that point, they had concluded that we should continue with a 92% compliance rate. In other words, that 92% of what we request from parishes would actually be received. Last year, 2015, the compliance rate, the actual compliance rate, was actually 96.2%. So once again, it's really important that we do receive the returns from parishes as the budget group continues to do its work over the latter part of the summer and into the fall. When I presented my report on the Friday evening, there were a number of issues that I brought before the council. First of all was a concern with the number of clergy currently on sick leave and some very serious illnesses that some of our clergy are dealing with at this point in time, and the kind of scramble to provide priestly coverage to those parishes. The provincial synod will take place in 2018, and we will be the host. So provincial synod will take place in June of 2018 here in Halifax, so we need to prepare for that event next year. My installation as Archbishop will take place in Cornerbrook, Newfoundland at the end of October, 1st of November, and that will be in concert with the consecration of the new Bishop of the Diocese of Western Newfoundland. I'm currently working on a new three-year itinerary of parish visits and regional visits. That's pretty much complete at this point. It will be circulated in the next couple of weeks. I visit parishes every Sunday, and every parish gets a visit at some point over the three-year course of the itinerary. So that'll be publicized and be available on the Diocesan website quite soon. One of the other interesting pieces of work that we're looking at as a diocese is our relationship with the Atlantic School of Theology. AST is currently involved in two major pieces of work, one of which is a redevelopment of the campus. Some significant building changes have been proposed, and how we'll fit into that or how the funding will be provided for that is yet to be determined, but will become a challenge, a question for us to look at sometime in the next few months. The other piece of work with AST is their periodic renegotiation of the Memorandum of Understanding, which creates the school. AST was founded by Anglican, Roman Catholic, and United Church partners over 40 years ago. And the mandate of the school and a significant amount of its operational funding comes from those three sources. The current Memorandum of Understanding expires in 2019, and already the work has begun to negotiate a renewed Memorandum of Understanding. So that'll be taking place over the next year. I updated the council on that. On June 17th, we had a day with a whole lot of reports from various folks and responsible for ministries around the diocese. The Reverend Lynn Uzans reported on vocations at the moment. Currently, there are 12 postulants for stipendiary ordained ministry, seven active, two that are semi-active, three are on hold at this point in time. Of the people currently in the process, 10 are male and 11 are female. And we also have another 9 inquirers that she is working with who have not yet begun formal discernment, but are asking questions and exploring what it means to be called to stipendiary ordained ministry. We were preparing at that time to celebrate the ordination of 4 transitional deacons, which did take place subsequent to the meeting. But Lynn noted that in 2018 there may not be any AST graduates for our diocese. She says their challenge for the diocese at this point in time is that she hasn't heard from a priest in the last 6 months who has said, "I have somebody who is discerning." And the question is, how do we nurture a call to leadership in the church? How do we discern vocations? Because primarily that happens at the parish level. It's when somebody senses a call to ministry and begins to explore that with the people whom they normally work and worship with, that then they refer to the discernment process in the diocese. So that is a real challenge for our church going forward. How do we identify those people? We heard a report from Dean Paul Smith of work at the cathedral. There's currently some structural work taking place on the south transept. And also that work continues on greening the cathedral. It's a large building with a large ecological footprint. So the cathedral continues to work at cutting heating costs and reducing paper product usage. There's some concern about security in the cathedral. The cathedral doors are open from 8:30 in the morning to 4 in the afternoon. There are not always staff people in the cathedral. So they have installed security cameras so that staff who are in the office can check on folks who may be in the cathedral at a given point in time. Paul also noted that the outreach budget this past year for the cathedral is topping $24,000. The cathedral is also taking a lead on the request to raise funds for the Anglican Church of Canada's Healing Fund. And this has been highlighted through the Giving with Grace appeal this year in 2017, an opportunity to replenish the funds that are used for healing in Indigenous communities around the country. There will be a special Diocesan Evensong, which will take place in October, wherein we hope to kind of finalize our fundraising efforts to the Healing Fund, and the Primate, Archbishop Hiltz, will be there that evening to receive our donation. The Diocesan Executive Director, Canon Gordon Redden, reported on some of his activities. He's been spending a lot of time in support of the human resources work, particularly as the group moved towards a recommendation on the medical plan. Also in the property sales, a number of parishes are selling pieces of property. In some cases, some churches that have been no longer used, and in some cases, some rectory property. And a lot of his time in terms of answering administrative questions about governance, parish governance. We're considering a renewal of the Parish Officer's Handbook. We haven't printed that in a number of years, and we're trying to figure out if we can do it in a kind of an electronic format, as sort of a podcast, to answer many of the common questions that are asked by parish officers. And once again, he underlined the need for parishes to submit their parochial returns. The canon requires them to be submitted by March 31st each year. And here we are in the middle of the summer, and a number of the returns have not yet been received. The returns are in two components. One is statistics, attendance statistics and so on, and then the second part is the financial return. Both are important to us. The financial, because as I said earlier, the budget task group uses it to prepare our diocesan budget, but the statistical return is also critical to us because our attendance statistics are used by the national church to assign the numbers of general synod delegates on an averaged basis over a three-year average. So we need to have these numbers received. We can't make them up, we can't fake them. We actually have to have the returns from parishes in order to make sure that we have adequate representation at General Synod. Reverend Lisa Vaughn reported on her work as Parish Vitality Coordinator. She highlighted a few things. First of all, the Vital Church Maritimes Conference taking place in Truro, September 21st to 23rd. It's entitled Streams of Hope. There is an early bird discount to August 22nd, both for the conference and for hotel. And registration is limited. So if you really want to go, you should register as soon as possible, and you can do so through the diocesan website. She noted that the Anglican Foundation is offering special grants this year for projects that aim to enhance and transform parish ministry. The foundation has been offering special grants over and above the three that each diocese can apply for I think it's about 4 years now. And this year the focus is on grants that will enhance or transform parish ministry. Each of these grants could go as high as $15,000. So imagine what you could do in your parish with $15,000. Well, you have to imagine in order to make an application. And you can apply directly to the foundation through their website, or you can see information in the Anglican Journal about the special grants. Four will be awarded nationally, and the deadline for application is September 1st of this year. Lisa spoke about the resource material that's available on our website with respect to Anglican identity, Christian formation, and follow-up when people begin to attend worship or begin to be involved in church. How do we integrate newcomers into the life of a congregation? And she spoke of a couple of programs in particular. There's one entitled the Pilgrim Course, which is basically catechesis, the teaching of the faith. And this is from the Church of England, and we have two copies in our resource center. It's a short series of 5 weeks. There is a new version of the Alpha program. You no longer have to pay for the resource. It's all available free for download from their website. And she also mentioned another program called START. We've not tested that one yet, she said, but it's available, and she's looking at how it might be used. The big question for parishes when they offer programs like this is, who is our audience? Who is it that you want to involve in these kinds of programs or offerings of one sort or another? She also noted that christianbook.com will give free samples of programs. So if you go to their website and something looks interesting, you can get a small portion of the program for free so that you can have a more intense look at what it might offer for your parish. The Youth and Family Ministry Coordinator, Ali Culp, talked about several of diocesan events that have taken place in the last couple of months. She reported on the team which attended a youth gathering in the Diocese of Eastern Newfoundland back late in the winter. She mentioned the Encounter Weekend, so this is a kind of reboot of the Teens Encounter Christ program, which took place in April. At Synod, there were 19 youth delegates present. And Ali highlighted the problem of engaging youth at Synod because it involves 2 days off of school. And realistically, that is sometimes a problem for involving any kind of representatives to Synod because it would involve 2 days off work as well, usually. So she spoke about some of the experience of youth members at Synod. The Diocesan Youth Conference will take place in October 27th to 29th. At the Malagash Bible Camp. Currently our diocese is working with the Diocese of Fredericton in developing the program. There will be training for leaders in various regions later in the summer, early in the fall. And this is not just for leaders for the Diocesan Youth Conference, but would be a benefit to anybody in youth leadership around the diocese. But those who will be in leadership at the Youth Conference must attend one of the training sessions. Allie also noted that she has a new resource website for youth material and for youth and family ministry. It's www.sharenspei.ca. And if you go onto the youth link on the diocesan website, it should take you there. But if you want to look for SHARENSPEI, that'll take you directly to a page where there are resources for youth and family ministry. And the last thing that Allie talked about was CLAY, the Canadian Lutheran Anglican Youth Gathering that takes place every 2 years. The next one will be in Thunder Bay in 2018. There are already three groups, parish groups or regional groups in our diocese who are planning to attend and are raising money to pay for the travel costs and the registration fees. Travel is still somewhat up in the air. At one point they were talking about renting a bus, but then thought maybe 2.5 or 3 days on a bus each way might not be the best way to travel. So that's still in the planning stage. Allie has also been asked to be the chair of the National Planning Committee for CLAY in 2020. And we don't even know where that one's going to be yet, but we'll have the inside track on the information once they begin their planning. If you are interested in more information about CLAY, Melinda Tattery in Truro is a contact person, or you can contact Allie Cole through her Synod Office contact address. Our Anglican Foundation Screening Committee presented two applications that had been received before the meeting. One was received the day of the meeting and unfortunately was not completed enough for us to really have a look at it. We had decided to forward two of the applications to the foundation, one for the parish of Chester and one for St. John's, St. Eleanor's in Prince Edward Island. So that brings to an end the applications that we can submit for 2017. We've only submit three a year. We'd already had one approved back in the spring, and these two will go to the fall board meeting of the foundation. So our next opportunity to submit applications won't be until the spring of 2018. Building Healthy Leadership, VSST, reported on the development of a workshop entitled Conflict Competent. It's about a 2.5-hour workshop to help people engage in courageous conversations. It's not about being conflict-free so much as conflict-competent, said Cynthia Pilichos, who is has been the team leader for Building Healthy Leadership. They have phrased it, the workshop, so as to be consistent with living our baptismal covenant. There are two parishes that have booked a presentation of this workshop for the fall, and the group would be open to some more later on. They also noted that Cynthia has come to the end of her term as team leader, so that we need to appoint a new team leader for Building Healthy Leadership. Youth and Family Ministry VSST once again shared information about SHARE, NSPEIdiocese.ca, and some more details about the planning for the Diocesan Youth Conference. The theme is Do Justice, Love Kindness, Walk Humbly. The team is also looking at a camping program, a diocesan camping program for 2018. Not as reliant on facilities. Of course, we do have two regional camps in the diocese, one in the Annapolis Valley and one in Cape Breton. But the team felt if they could create the substantive program for a week-long camp, it could be used at either of those facilities, but it could also be used in parishes as a kind of a day camp. So they did apply for a Growth for Ministry grant to help develop the program, and in fact they have received that grant. So they'll be designing the program over the winter months and be ready to go hopefully with this program in 2018, summer of 2018. A written report was received from the Mission Outreach Social Justice VSST, some focus on the ongoing and ever-increasing work of the Environmental Network. there's quite a number of people now that are tied into this network around the diocese. They don't meet, but they distribute information about various environmental projects and programs and issues that are facing us as Christians, as Anglicans, and as members of the provinces of Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island. So it's wonderful work they're doing. The council also endorsed a submission to the federal government's consultation on poverty reduction. Andy Sharon had prepared the submission on behalf of the team. That was also circulated at Synod, so most people hopefully there saw a copy of it, and Diocesan Council endorsed it as a position of the diocese. We did talk about Synod. We had a report from the Synod Arrangements Committee, the follow-up, looking at the evaluations. We had some conversations about seating, whether it's best to have people seated at the tables in parish groups or regional groups, or just to let people sit wherever they wanted to sit. And I think the consensus was that there was no consensus, that at certain points in time or in the process, one kind of seating pattern might work better than another, which, interesting enough, is how the General Synod does its seating when it meets as well. At certain points you sit as diocesan groups, and at certain points you're seated at mixed table groups. There was conversation about kind of some of the perennial problems we face about parking, and if there is ways that we might be able to get temporary parking passes from Dalhousie if there's not as much activity on the campus at that point of the year. Overall, the evaluations were quite positive about our most recent synod, and we'll be using those, of course, when we get ready to plan for our next synod, which would take place in May of 2018. One of the follow-up pieces was in regards to the motion that was passed to change the canon to permit raffles. The debate at Synod largely revolved around being able to raffle artisanal products. There was a lot of mention of quilts and paintings and other artisanal products, which very rarely get their true value if they're sold through kind of parish sales. So the debate did carry. As I said, the resolution did pass. The canon was changed to permit the raffling of donated items. Now, since Synod, I've been asked all kinds of questions as to what constitutes donated items, and most of the questions have nothing to do with artisanal products, everything from cars to bottles of booze, none of which was mentioned in the midst of that debate at Synod. So, Diocesan Council did pass a motion at the meeting to create a small task group of three people who, between now and our next meeting in October, would prepare some draft guidelines for parishes as to how we might use this opening in the canon. So the parishes could in fact offer raffles, but it would be consistent with our life as church and as parish. So anyways, more information on that to come when we get to the fall. But one of the pieces, incidentally, that they'll be looking at is the actual provincial regulations in both Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island regarding raffles and, I guess, roughly speaking, or generally speaking, lotteries. Because at this moment, I think most of us are fairly ignorant of these regulations. So we need to know what those are. Our last report was from the Financial Management and Development team. And they had several recommendations for us to look at. One was that we had provided $20,000 in this year's budget as transitional funding, as Peter Fleming came to the end of his tenure as our controller and we went to hire a new one, and the overlap period and training, well, that's not going to happen now. Peter's going to be around until 2018. So we're not going to need that $20,000 this year. So the Financial Management and Development VSST recommended that we use that money to hire a person with skills in the area, an appropriate HR specialist, to help us review staff positions in the office. We haven't reviewed the actual job descriptions in the Synod office in a number of years. They've been changing. They've been changing radically in the last 4 years, as many of the work functions in this office have changed. And we continually tweak our job descriptions here in the office, but there hasn't been an overall sort of analysis now for a couple of years. and commensurate with that, are we paying people appropriately for the jobs that they are now doing? So that was the recommendation of the VSST. Council approved that. Part of that analysis will also be a look at my work routines in this office. There was some concern that with my election as Metropolitan, that's another layer of work involved over top of an already full agenda. So how would all this balance out? Are there parts of the work that I'm currently doing that perhaps could be done by others, and perhaps more efficiently by others than what I am doing right now? And overall, behind that look or that analysis is the sense that we need to be thinking, even here in the office, in a missional mindset. How are we extending God's kingdom in this place by the work that we do here and by the resources that we offer to parishes through this office? So hopefully that will take place this fall. We now have funding in place that will allow us to do that. Our investment managers have offered us a fossil-free fund. Well, it's not free, but anyways, it means that we won't be investing in corporations that produce fossil fuels, and this is in alignment with a motion that Diocesan Council had passed last winter, that we withdraw our investments over a period of time from producers of fossil fuels. So the investment managers have now offered us a way forward so that we can comply with that. The mortgage management, the diocese of course has a mortgage fund through mortgage loan and property, the church extension fund, where we extend mortgages to parishes. Currently, once we approve them, they're managed by the TD Bank. They've given us some indication that they're changing the way they do business, and we have decided to bring the management of those mortgages back in-house. It's mostly a bookkeeping exercise. We already do the approval process in-house, so we're not changing that at all. So this will save us a little bit on the administration fee every month that they charge us. However, we will also need a little bit extra staff time in here, so it'll probably come out to close to a wash. Won't be a whole lot of savings involved. The debate that's been going on for the last 6 months or so about moving from buildings to mission in terms of allotment exemptions continues. There was a report presented at Synod. Given that this will require a canonical change, we have another 2 years before we can actually affect any change. And even at that point, there is proposed to be a kind of phase in. So this will be a long-term project to change the way that we look at allotment and what is exempted from allotment calculations. The council gave permission for the task group to continue its work until June of 2018. And also we agreed with the request to have the Canons and Constitution task group to develop a motion for Synod in 2019 to strip down the canon, Canon 16, with respect to what it says about allotment exemptions, to something a little bit more simple and well-defined. So council did agree to that request. The last thing we did out of financial management and development, and if you heard me earlier, you heard me say the task group on the budget said they were recommending a 92% compliance rate to build the budget for 2018. Council requested the budget task group instead to use a 94% compliance rate. We have had surpluses for the last 3 years, and there was a sense that we're kind of lowballing the compliance rate that we're using to make our calculations, so that if we actually used a calculation that might be closer to what is actually happening, that would provide us with the means to actually plan how to spend that money rather than figuring out what to do with a surplus at the end of the year. This is a little bit audacious. It's not conservative at all. We've been playing it conservative for the last number of years, but there was a sense in which we wanted to be a little bit bold, and I won't say it's risky, because it's not risky at all, but at least to be fair to the way in which parishes have been supporting the work of the diocese through the allotment rate. We've exceeded the 94% compliance rate for each of the last 3 years, and council felt that it was time that we actually moved our planning to reflect the reality of that. So that was the last piece of business we did for the Diocesan Council. We'll meet again in the middle of October. Thank you. God bless.